filling in for Kim today, and he's still in the pastor preseason. I was just going to rehash something that I did a few years ago, but it's kind of appropriate for this holiday weekend. It's from Max Lucado, called Sacrificial General. In Matthew 20:28, in the same way, the Son of Man did not come to be served. He came to serve others and give his life as a ransom for many people. For there's no greater love than one who lays down his life for another. The decision had been made. The troops had been deployed and the battleships were on the way. Nearly 3 million soldiers were preparing to slam against Hitler's Atlantic wall in France. D-Day was set in motion. Responsibility for the invasion fell squarely on the four-star general's shoulders of Dwight E. Eisenhower. The general spent the night before the attack with the men of the 101st Airborne. They called themselves the Screaming Eagles. And his men prepared their planes and checked their equipment. Ike went from soldier to soldier, offering words of encouragement. Many of the flyers were young enough to be his sons. He treated them as if they were. A correspondent wrote that Eisenhower watched the C-47s take off and disappear into the darkness. His hands were sunk deeply into his pockets, and his eyes full of tears. The general then went to his quarters and sat at his desk. He took a pen and paper and wrote a message which would be delivered to the White House in the event of a defeat. It was as brief as it was courageous. He said, "Our landings have failed. The troops, the air, and the Navy did all that bravery and devotion to duty could do. If any blame or fault attaches itself to the attempt, it was mine alone." It could be argued that the greatest act of courage that day was not in a cockpit or a foxhole, but at the desk when the one at the top took responsibility for the ones below. When the one in charge took the blame, even before the blame needed to be taken. Rare leader, this general. Unusual, this display of courage. He modeled a quality seldom seen in our society of lawsuits, dismissals, and divorces. Most of us are willing to take credit for the good we do. Some are willing to take the rap for the bad we do. But few will assume the responsibilities for the mistakes of others. Still fewer will shoulder the blame for mistakes yet uncommitted. Eisenhower did. As a result, he became a hero. Jesus did. As a result, he's our Savior. Before the war began, he forgave. Before a mistake could be made, forgiveness was offered. Before blame could be given, grace was provided. The one at the top took responsibility for the ones at the bottom. Jesus describes what he came to do. The Son of Man did not come to be served. He came to serve others and to give his life for a ransom for many people. The phrase Son of Man conjured up the same images for the Jew of Christ era that the title General creates for you and me. It was a statement of authority and power. Consider all the titles Jesus could have used to define himself on earth. King of Kings, the Great I Am, the Beginning and the End, the Lord of All, Jehovah, High and Holy. All these and a dozen others would have been appropriate. But Jesus didn't use them. Instead, he called himself the Son of Man. This title appears 82 times in the New Testament, 81 which are in the Gospels, 80 of them which are directly from To understand Jesus, we need to understand what this title means. If Jesus thought it important enough for you to use it at any time, it is certainly important enough for us to explore. Few would argue that the title is rooted in Daniel 7, a text which is one frame of the cinematographic masterpiece. This here is afforded a seat to the theater that features a peek into the future powers of the earth. The empire is portrayed as beasts, rapid, hungry, and vicious. The lion with the eagle's wings stands for Babylonia, and the bear with the three ribs in its mouth represents Medo-Persia. Alexander the Great is symbolized by a leopard with four wings and four heads, and a fourth beast with iron teeth represents Rome. But as the scenes unfold, the empires fade. One by one, world powers tumble. At the end, the conjuring god, the Ancient of Days, receives into his presence the Son of Man. To him is entrusted authority, glory, and sovereign power. Picture him blazing white atop a gallant steed, a sword in his hand. To the Jew, the Son of Man was a symbol of triumph, the conqueror, the equalizer, the score settler, the big brother, the intimidator, Starship Enterprise, the right arm of the high and holy, the king who roared down from the heavens in a fiery chariot of vengeance and anger toward those who oppressed God's holy people. The Son of Man was a four-star general who called his army to invade and lead his troops to victory. For that reason, when Jesus spoke of the Son of Man in terms of power, the people cheered. When he spoke of a new world where the Son of Man would sit on this glorious throne, people understood. When he spoke of the Son of Man who would come on the clouds of heaven with great power and authority, the people could envision the scene. When he spoke of the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power, everyone could imagine the picture. But when he said the Son of Man would suffer, the people stood silent. This didn't fit the image. It's not what they expected. Put yourself in their place. You've been oppressed by the Roman government for years. Since your youth, you have been taught that the Son of Man would deliver you. Now he's here. Jesus calls himself the Son of Man. He proves he is the Son of Man. He can raise the dead and still a storm. The crowds of followers are growing. You're excited. Finally, the children of Abraham will be set free. But what's this he's saying? The Son of Man did not come to be served. He came to serve others. Earlier, he told them, the Son of Man will be handed over to the Gentiles, and they will kill him. After 3 days, he will rise from the dead. Wait a minute. That's impossible, incredible, intolerable. Contradiction of terms. No wonder the followers did not understand what Jesus meant. They were afraid to ask him. The king who came to serve, the Son of Man being betrayed, the conqueror killed, the ambassador of the ancient days mocked, spit upon. But such is the irony of Jesus wearing the title Son of Man. It is also the irony of the cross. Calvary is a hybrid of God's lofty status and his deep devotion. The thunderclap which echoed when God's sovereignty collided with his love. The marriage of heaven's kingship and heaven's compassion. The very instrument of the cross, symbolic, the vertical beam of holiness intersecting with the horizontal bar of love. Jesus wears a sovereign crown but bears the Father's heart. He is a general who takes responsibility for his soldiers. But Jesus didn't write a note. He paid the price. He didn't just assume the blame. He seized the sin. He became the ransom. He is a general who dies in the place of the private. The king who suffers for the peasants. The master who sacrificed himself for the servant. He is a general who made provision for his soldiers' mistakes. He is the Son of Man who come to serve and give his life as a ransom to you. Tomorrow, we will pause in remembrance of the men and women of the armed service who gave their lives, sacrificed their lives for our freedom, that we can stand here today and worship together and for our flag. We honor them and we thank them. Take time out tomorrow and honor them. Right before Jesus' hour, he was in a garden. And he prayed three times. He said, Father, if it is possible, take this cup from me. I believe it. His father's heart swelled, his head bowed. He said, no, son, it's not possible. For our sacrifice will redeem man. Our sacrifice will fill our kingdom. Jesus picked up that cup, went to the cross, and he laid his life down. As we prepare for the table today, we take the bread which represents his broken, bruised body. The cup of the vine, fruit of the vine, represents the blood shed for our sins. We do this in remembrance. We do this in remembrance of our sacrifice, God.
Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Father, as we approach this table this morning, remembrance of the broken body and the spilled blood, that we might be saved, that we might have salvation, that we might sit with you in your kingdom. partake of this bread and juice in humility and acceptance of your love. Bless this sacrament that we partake of this morning, that we might be strengthened and nourished in your love, and that others may see Christ come alive in us in everything we do. We ask this in Jesus' name.
in prayer. Our majestic and loving Heavenly Father, Lord, in keeping with in obedience to your command, Lord, we first have, as we approach your throne, giving ourselves first to you, denying ourselves, and offering our bodies to you. Lord, we also want to be in obedience as we contemplate the many blessings you've bestowed upon us and the abundance of all we've received. Lord, may we search our hearts and may our hearts reflect those our offering as our loving offering to you, that, Lord, for the love that you've shown to us as we return the portion of these gifts to you. Lord, may you these gifts be used to further your kingdom. Lord, may you be again honored through these gifts. We ask, Lord, that you just shine upon this body here. Lord, that you could use us in a mightily way. We ask all these things now as we lift this prayer up to you in Christ's name. Amen.
Reading from Psalm 1. And I hope everybody can see it from where you are, because I want everybody to read it. It's not just me reading, it's everybody reading. So if you're ready, let's begin. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted under the rivers of water, which brings forth its fruit in season. Also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. He'll not have none to us, but by the shaft which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand into the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish.
Thank you very much. And thanks for the beautiful communion rendition Jeff gave us this morning. And thank you, Neil, for filling in such a short notice. I really appreciate it. So that's basically what we're talking about this morning. Psalm 1 is a favorite of mine. I guess I delight in Psalm 1. It is easily divided into four different points. And the first one, verse 1, talks about the blessed man. Verse 2 talks about the delight of the blessed man. And verse 3 talk about the reward of the blessed man. And verse 4 through 6 talk about the ungodly man. So it takes about basically 3 to 4 hours to get through all of that. So this morning we're going to deal with verse 1 and verse 2. And as we were singing this morning, that song, I Need Thee Every Hour, I got to thinking how close this delight business is to our need for God every hour. And they really just mesh so beautifully. Psalm 1 is a very powerful presentation of the gospel. A lot of people believe that that the Old Testament is the Old Testament, and the New Testament is the presentation of Christ. All through the Old Testament you'll find presentation about Christ. And this is one of them right now. Beautiful presentation of the gospel. It is definitely a comparison between the righteous and the wicked, between the good and the evil, between the Christian and the Christless, between the believer and the non-believer. Someone assures the believer of his or her hope in God's kingdom and warns the non-believer of the tragic that awaits him or her, tragic end. And in contrast, the abundant blessings of the believer with the final condemnation of the unbeliever. So it's in one little package there. It does all of this. It's so beautiful. It describes the blessed man. He walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor does he stand in the way of sinners, nor does he sit in the seat of the scornful. And this is presented kind of in the name, does not. How about does, in a positive way? The ungodly man walks in the counsel of the ungodly. He stands in the way of sinners, and he sits in the seat of scornful. So it's presented both from a negative way and a positive way. Lesson Bible Dictionary interprets this verse this way. It reads, the unnamed psalmist describes the godly man both negatively and positively. He lists three types of sinners, three types of sin, and three places of sin that are available to, but not frequently, by the godly man. This is the way he said it, in the ascending order. He walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. When you interpret that, it means basically he does not conduct his way according to worldly standards. Secondly, he stands not in the way of sinners. that generally comes out to me, he does not make his associations with evil men. And thirdly, he sits not in the seat of the scornful. He does not fellowship with those who scorn God. And as you look at the different, the walk, the stand, and the sit, you see it's getting worse and worse. The sinner is being tempted more and more to become more sinful. So the ungodly man here is obviously being enticed by sin more and more, while the godly man has to follow what Jesus said in Matthew 22:37, which is, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength, and with all thy soul. And it's interesting how different people have looked on this particular verse 1, which we're talking about right now. The ungodly man, according to Prudence Complete Concordance, says this about him: a scorner, as the word is used in the scripture, he says, is one who makes a mock of God's condemnation of sin and of God's threatenings and judgment against sinners. You don't want to be in that place. We don't want to be in that place. I haven't heard that word used very much in the United States, but it used to be used a lot in Belize. When you scorn something, it's really a bad thing, to put it in that way. So we don't want to be in that. Spurgeon had some things to say about that. He said, the seat of the scorner may be very lofty, but it is very near to the gate of hell. Let us flee from it, for it shall soon be empty, and destruction shall swallow up the man that sits therein. That's pretty deep words there. And Webster College Dictionary defines scornful as to treat or regard with contempt or disdain. That's what the ungodly man does when he reaches his worst state of sitting in the seat of the scornful. We have no business fellowshipping with people who treat our God like that. Isaiah 29:18-20 tells us, and in that day shall the deaf hear the words of the book, and the eyes of the blind shall see out of the obscurity and of darkness. The meek also shall increase their joy in the Lord, and the poor among men shall rejoice in the Holy One of Israel, for the terrible one is brought naught, the scorner is consumed, and all that watch for iniquity are cut off. So that verse 1 has so much right in that little verse that we ought to be very careful about all the time and try to avoid not to walk in the counsel of the ungodly, not to stand in the way of sinners, not to sit in the seat of the seeker scornful. Verse 2 then tells us what the ungodly man does. He doesn't do those things, but tells us what it is. So he said, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. And that's where we want to put the emphasis this morning, to delight in the law of the Lord. So the blessed man walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. But he, the blessed man, delights in the law of the Lord. Psalm 119:77 says, let thy tender mercies come upon me, that I may live, for your law is my delight. There's a bunch of stuff in the Bible about the delighting in God's law. And this is God's law here, by the way. This is what we're supposed to be delighting in day and night. And this morning, we're going to do a little bit of delighting in God's law. In other words, we're going to read a lot of it. So let's start off with Genesis 1:1. Everybody know that one. So let's say it together. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. We'll stop right there and preach a whole sermon on that, but that's not enough delighting. So let's continue with our delighting this morning in God's Word and go to Deuteronomy 28. And we're going to read. I'm not going to wait for you to find it because you're going to get hungry. Deuteronomy 28, 1 to 8. And this shall come to pass. This is the blessings that happen. One, some of the benefits we get from delighting in God's Word. And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments which I command you this day, that the Lord your God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on you and overtake you, if you shall hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Blessed shalt thou be, shall be the fruit of your body, and the fruit of your ground, and the fruit of your cattle, the increase of your kind, and the flocks of your sheep. Blessed shall be thy basket and thy store. Blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. The Lord shall cause thine enemies that rise up against you to be smitten before your face. They shall come out against you one way, and they shall flee before you seven ways. Wow! The Lord shall command the blessing upon thee in thy storehouses, and in all that thou settest thine hand unto, and he shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God gives you. Delight in the law of the Lord. Oh, it's beautiful, isn't it? And then we go a little bit further and look at Psalm 46. This has been one of the passages of Scripture that I've delighted in for a long, long time now. Psalm 46, which reads, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. Anybody got troubles?
No.
No troubles. Well, you're pretty fortunate if you don't have troubles. A lot of us have troubles of different kinds, financial, health, name it. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved, the earth uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he has made in the earth. He makes wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaks the bow, he cuts the spear in sunder, he burns the chariot in fire. Be still, he says, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is your refuge. Oh, it's so good to have a refuge. It's so many times we are so overwhelmed with the things that are around us that we have to deal with day by day. And here, delighting in God's word, he is our refuge and our strength. And then Psalm 104. This is another one of my favorite for a long time. Talks about the majesty and the power of our God. And sometimes we fail to realize that, you know, that God is so great that there is absolutely nothing too hard for him to do. And we come up with our problems, whatever those problems are, and we want to try to solve them ourselves, and then we can't solve them by ourselves, and then we go to the doctor, and the doctor can't solve them by himself, and we go to the financial advisor, and he can or she can't solve them for us, and finally we start praying. But we got our refuge right here. Why are we going to wait so long? Psalm 104 says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, thou art very great. You clothed in honor and majesty. You cover yourself with light as with a garment." That's all God. You know there won't be any sun in heaven? God is the light. He will be shining all over heaven for us. Who lays the beams of his chambers in the waters? Who makes the clouds his chariot? Who walks on the wings of the wind? Wow. Who makes his angels spirits, his ministers a flaming fire? Who laid the foundations of the earth so that it should not be removed forever? You cover it with the deep as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. At your rebuke they fled. At the voice of your thunder they hasted away. They go up to the mountains. They go down to the depths, to a place you have prepared for them. You have set a bound that they pass no more to cover the earth. Maybe that's why we have the rainbow. Because it says you no longer want to cover the earth. Here in Psalm 104 it says you have set a bound that they may not pass over, that they turn not again to cover the earth. It's all one. Delight in the law of the Lord. He sends the springs in the valley which run among the hills. They give drink to every beast of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. By them shall the fowls of heaven have their habitation, which sing among the branches. He waters the hills from the chambers. The earth is satisfied with the fruit of your works. Delight in the law of the Lord. He causes the grass to grow for the cattle, and herb for the service of man, that he might bring forth food out of the earth, and wine that makes glad the heart of man, and oil that makes his face to shine, and bread which strengthens a man's heart. The trees of the Lord are full of sap. The cedars of Lebanon which he has planted, where the birds make their nest. As for the stalk, the fir trees are her house. The high hills are a refuge for the wild goats, and the rocks for the conies. And just continue through the song, telling of both of God's greatness, how God is great, and greatly to be praised. Says the Thou makest the darkness, and it is night, wherein all the beasts of the forest do creep forth. The young lions roars after their prey, and seek their meat from God. The sun rises, they gather themselves together, lay them down in their dens. Man goes to work and to labor until the evening. O Lord, how manifold are your works, in wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your glory. So is this great and wide sea, wherein are things creeping innumerable, both small and great beasts. These all wait upon you that you may give them their food in their season. So givest them, they gather, you open your hand, they're filled with good. You hide your face, they're troubled. You take away their breath and they die. You send forth your spirit and they're renewed, and you renew the face of the earth. Delight in the word of God. Delight in the law of God. That's what he's telling us to do here in Psalm 1. And then it ends up in Psalm 104 with the words, "The glory of the Lord shall endure forever. The Lord shall rejoice in his works. He looks on the earth and it trembles. He touched the hills, they smoke. The Lord shall glory in the works that he has done. I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. I will delight in the law of the Lord." No, that's not part of that. But anyhow, "My meditation of him shall be sweet. I will be glad in the Lord. Let the sinners be consumed out of the earth, and let the wicked man be no more. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Praise ye the Lord." Delight in the law of the Lord. And then we move to the New Testament. And John 17:24. I think I want something before this. Matthew 5:13-16. This is where Jesus is telling us what we're supposed to be like. what we're supposed to be delighting in. And he says, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast off and be trodden under the foot of men. You are the light of the world, he said. The city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and set it on a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it gives light to all that are in the house. Then Jesus says, let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Oh, that we could delight in the law of the Lord. In John 17, 24, Jesus has just had the Last Supper. He's talking to his disciples. He's trying to build them up and strengthen them up so that when he leaves in a few hours, they'll be able to carry on the work that he has done. And then in John 17, he's praying to his Father. And he did a lot of praying before he came to verse 24. And he said, Father, I will that they also whom you have given me be with me where I am. Well, I'm glad he's praying that prayer for me, because that's where I want to be, where he is. And he wants me to be there, and he wants you to be here, and I hope you want to be there too. That they may behold my glory. Can you imagine when we get to heaven? You ever think about it? I'm so close, I think about it. But when we get to heaven, and we're here, well done, good and faithful servant, that's what we hear. And we walk into heaven, the White House does not begin to compare. The Queen's Palace cannot begin to compare with what you'll be walking into. And it's all yours. And you got Jesus is up there now preparing a place for each of us if we want to go there. Beheld my glory, and we see Jesus and all the light that is shining around, and that beautiful river running through heaven, and all the big fishes that you can catch, and don't throw back. But one hour we'll be there, we'll see his glory shining without the sun, and the river, he says, runs under the throne. Man, that would be great. And here Jesus is praying for us, he says, I want them to come, Father. I want them to be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. And what which you have given me before, for you loved me before the foundations of the world. Oh, let us delight in the law of the Lord. And so we started this morning delighting with Genesis chapter 1. And we finished delighting. No, this is just finished temporarily, right? Because you're going to go home and start delighting in more of the word of the Lord. So here we are. Revelation 21, 1 to 7 says, and I like this, the inheritance we have, folks, if we can only grasp the inheritance we have. You know, on this earth, families get break up at the death of someone because they all want to grab piece of what is there, although they may not have cared for the person before they left. But the inheritance that we have as Christians who are delighting in the Word of God, it's almost unimaginable. And here John is telling us in Revelation 21 part of that inheritance. He says in verse 1 to 7, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the city, a new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven, from God, out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Everybody likes a wedding, right? Everybody who hears, well done, good and faithful servant, will like entering through the gates of heaven. And I saw the city, the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any pain. Anybody has pain?
Sure.
There shall be no pain there,
sure.
For the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Delight in the law of the Lord. That's what we instruct you to do. And many times, and I've said this before right here, that many times we have been admonished from this lectern to read the Bible, to study the Bible, to memorize the Bible. This is the law of the Lord. And we start out saying, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. If you believe that, then delight in the rest of the world. All through Revelation. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, that famous German pastor, asked a question one time in which I'm fascinated by the question that he asked. And the question that he asked was, why should it have to be the bad people that make revolution? No, sure, we can think of some good people that make revolution, but generally we think of the bad people making revolutions. And I wish we could tell Dietrich Bonhoeffer, I think he was hanged. I think hanging is the way they killed him. During World War II. But I wish we could tell him this morning, and if we can't tell him this morning, we can tell Jesus this morning. We're going to start a revolution at the old Christian church. And this revolution that I'm suggesting, we don't use bombs and guns, we don't kill people. We don't subdue nations. We delight in the law of the Lord. That's going to be our revolution. To delight in the law of the Lord. You know, Jesus said, when he was, just before he was going to be arrested, can you not watch with me 1 hour, with his disciples? And I'm putting that same question to you tonight. I mean, yeah, today. Can you not delight in the law of the Lord 1 hour? Can you do it for 45 minutes? 30 minutes a day? 15 minutes a day?
Forever.
Don't go less than 15 minutes a day, please. So let's spend some time. Imagine what would happen in this congregation, in North Fort Myers, if every one of us here would delight in the law of the Lord, would spend an hour a day delighting in God's word. Imagine, just use your mind a little bit and see what would happen. It would be a revolution. God gave us 24 hours a day. Can we give him an hour for that? 4 or 5 minutes? You might have to start at 15 minutes. Maybe your life right now is so organized that it's hard to find an hour. Start with 15 minutes. Start with Psalm 1. It takes less than 15 minutes to read. But delight in the law of the Lord. Nikita Khrushchev, I think it was, back in the 1960s, of course, I think 70s, says, "Give me 100 men, and I will change the world." You got more than 100 men, but communism from then is still rampant towards some countries in the world today. And he was right about that. And I could guarantee you this morning that if we would delight in the Lord for an hour a day, we would revolutionize this church. We would fill all these empty pews. We'd have to get more pews. The parking lots would be full. And people out there will be wondering, what's going on over there as they drive past? We better go and see what's happening there. It'll be a revolution.
We'll change the world.
And so I'm inviting you that we all join together and making a resolution to have a revolution this morning. At the beginning of this service, you were asked to list five things in which you delight. Is the law of the Lord one of those five? You don't have to answer me. It's your business. I don't really need to know. But I'm trying to say it should be one of those five. So let us this morning concentrate on this as we give an invitation for us to come together and make a decision on what we want to do with God's Word. Let us determine to delight in the law of the Lord. And there will be an invocation given this morning for us to make that commitment. And you don't really need to come up here this morning and do that. You could make that commitment where you are. You could make that commitment later on today. You could decide even not to eat lunch and to just delight in the law of the Lord for this day. But take it in. And let us begin to read our Bible on a regular basis and seek the will of God and delight in His Word. The Savior is waiting. Enter your heart. Won't you let him come in? Won't you promise him? Won't you delight in his word? Let us stand and sing. seek to become more like you. And help us to obey your word and to delight in the laws of the Lord and to become more like you want us to be, that you can mold us and make us into the people you want us to be your servants and your sons and your daughters, in which you can be pleased. And go with us today wherever we go, and impress upon our minds and our hearts how important it is for us to delight in you, and if so, delight in your word. And help us to be the shining lights that you created us to be. Let us see your good works and glorify you, and to be the salt and the light of the world, and to season those around us, our families, our friends, our loved ones, our neighbors, with the salt of your Holy Ghost, and to dissipate the darkness that surrounds us with the light of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So help us to be your servants today, Father, we pray, and spread your words and delight in the law of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray and ask these things. Thanking you. Amen.